So by now you are probably thinking, we have a physical device and we are good to go, right? Well, not exactly. The physical device handle represents everything that the actual hardware can do. The cues, the features, etc. In some cases, you don't need all the features, or you want to create a combination of several cue families. Therefore, Vulkan provides a notion of a logical device, which represents the specific subset of the physical device which will be used in the current application. This idea encourages tailoring the behavior of the Vulkan driver to the specific requirements at hand. Alright, so we have initialized our huge database of one or two physical devices right here, and we have selected one of them to be used in this session or this application. And this function returns one of the cue families to be used here. Now, I've been getting some heat over the way that I do this initialization in its simplicity. So I'd like to stress the fact that this is just the first demo. So I'm keeping things as simple as possible, and things will become more complex as we move into more complex demos in the future, and specifically improve the performance. Okay, so don't worry. So the next step is to create the device. Let's go down here. And let's jump to the end of this function for a second. So the function that creates the logical device is called createDevice. It needs the handle of the physical device which it will reference. Okay, so we go to our physical device database. We use the selected function again. And this function returns the physical device structure, which contains our physical device handle. So we get it right here. We need the address of a device create info structure right here, null for the allocator, and the address of the result, a handle of the logical device, which is a simple VK device. Okay, don't confuse that with the VK physical device. Now this structure takes care of several things. First of all, we have the queue configuration of the logical device. This will be a subset of the queues of the physical device. This is actually a pointer to an array, and we have the number of elements in that array, in this case just one element, which is defined up here. Device queue create info. Each of these structures references a single queue family, so we set the queue family index to be the index of the queue family which we got back when we called select device. Next, we set the queue count, which is the number of queues from this family. So this value must be less than or equal to what this family provides. We can use all the queues in the family or just some of them. For basic rendering, one queue is enough, and we will probably want more queues to take advantage of the parallelism on the GPU. Next, we have the queue priorities. This is also an array. So for each queue here, we need a corresponding element in this array. In this case, since we have one queue, we have one element here. The values of the priorities go from 0 to 1. Okay, so 0 is the lowest priority and 1 is the highest. Now, the issue of queue priorities is kind of vague, and GPUs may differ from one another in terms of how they can assign priorities. The physical device property structure actually includes an attribute that specifies the number of priority levels that are supported on the physical device. So if you specify like 10 queues with 10 different priorities and the device supports only two levels, it means that most of them will be ignored. I consider this to be somewhat of an advanced feature, so we'll not go into more details right now. We'll get back to this in the future. Back to the device create info. As I said, we have just one queue create info structure. If you need more families, then you will need to expand that. The next two attributes used to allow you to specify layers on the device level. Okay, we have layers on the instance level, and we used to have this one, and this was actually deprecated, so just put 0 here and null here. Next, we have the device level extensions, and as usual, this is an array, and this is the number of elements in the array, and I'm using a vector, which is defined up here. We have the swap chain extension. The swap chain is kind of parallel to the idea of a default frame buffer In OpenGL, it contains a queue of images that we are going to render into. We're going to go into more details in the next video, but it's interesting to note that this is an extension, okay? It's not part of the core Vulkan specification. Next, we have the shader draw parameters extension, which provides access to three built-in shader variables, the base instance, the base vertex, and the draw index. And we've been using some of them in the OpenGL tutorials, so I guess we will need them here as well. And finally, we have the enabled features of the logical device, which I seem to forgot. So it is defined up here. Let's put this down here. We need the address. Now, this structure contains all sorts of capabilities, as you can see. And it's probably a good idea to enable just the features that you need. So this will allow the Vulkan driver to perform better. So the question is, which features are supported in the physical device? And as it turns out, I also forgot to query this information in the previous video. So I've added it to the init function of the Vulkan physical devices class. At the end of the for loop over all the physical devices, we call get physical device features, and we provide the address of the corresponding structure right here. So now that we have this information, we can make sure that the selected physical device supports the geometry shader as well as the tessellation shader, which are two features that we will enable here. As usual in this series, if one of these features is not available, then this will exit. But in an actual game, you may want to have some sort of a backup plan for that. So now that the device create info structure is fully populated, we can call create device and hopefully everything is working correctly. Also remember to destroy the logical device, which is what we do in the destructor by calling destroy device. Right guys, that's it for today. Thanks for watching and I'll see you next time.